Hey guys, what's up? It's Savannah. Welcome back to my channel. So for today's video, we are back doing another serial killer video. I think it was back in March or somewhere around there, I did my first serial killer video and I said that I was gonna make it a series and then I just never made another one. I don't really have an excuse for that. I ran a poll on Twitter asking what true crime video you guys wanted to see next and serial killer actually won by a lot. This one I'm really, really excited about, which is probably not the right way to describe it because I had never heard of this person before I started doing research on what serial killer I wanted to pick for today's video. I wanted to do someone who wasn't the straight obvious. So for today's video, we are talking about Israel Keyes. Israel Keyes is a serial killer who committed multiple murders between the years of 2001 to 2012. So this is a fairly recent time period. I watched multiple documentaries about him and read a bunch of articles on him. And as we get into his journey and story and things like that, you'll start to realize he's unlike any other serial killer in the way that he is just purely driven on killing and doesn't have a particular profile or a particular type of person that he goes after. Let's jump into who Israel Keyes was. Israel Keyes was born on January 7th of 1978 in Richmond, Utah. He was one of 10 children and he was homeschooled as well as raised in a Mormon family. His home life and his upbringing was very religious and he was pretty sheltered throughout his childhood. After living in Utah for a while, his family decided to move to Colville, Washington. Pretty sure that's how you say it, Colville, Washington. Israel wasn't your typical child as far as his hobbies and what he liked to do. As a young child, he liked to carry around a pistol everywhere he went with him. At 14 years old, his grandpa gave him a .38 caliber revolver. Him and his friends also had a bad habit of just breaking into homes and burglarizing them, stealing things, and he also enjoyed torturing animals for fun, whether that was cats, dogs, any type of animal that he could torture. He found enjoyment out of that, and as he grew up, he developed a sort of sadist attitude, which is someone who enjoys inflicting pain on themselves and others and gets off on that type of stuff. Israel wasn't surrounded by the best influences and the best company either. When his family moved to Colville, Washington, they moved next door to a family called the Keyes, I believe is how it's pronounced, and the Keyes had a son named Chevy. And Chevy was only about 5 years older than Israel, but when you're growing up at that point, you know, you kind of look up to people who are older than you and you kind of want to be like them and you kind of just want to be accepted and fit in with people like that. So he was always around Chevy, and Chevy was probably the worst influence Israel could have ever had. Chevy is now serving 3 life sentences for kidnapping, torture, and murder. But also let it be clear that Chevy's behavior does not excuse Israel's behavior in a way, you know? It's not like, oh, because of Chevy, like, Israel became insane. You know, over the years, Israel just grew really violent tendencies that most kids and most people in general do not have. He admitted several times that his idol was Ted Bundy, and if you don't know who Ted Bundy is, he is a infamous serial killer. Israel said that he really admired Ted Bundy's tendency to kill and his admiration to inflict pain on others. He really just admired and was inspired to be like Ted Bundy. Israel and his family ended up moving around a bunch, and Israel just on his own ended up moving around a bunch. He lived in New York for a couple months, he lived in Oregon, he lived in Washington. And while he was living in Oregon, it was the summer of 1997 or 1998. No article I found was actually ever able to pinpoint what year it was because no one ever came forward in this charge. And the only person who admitted to this was Israel himself, and he didn't say whether it was the summer of 97 or 98. He said one or the other. So in Oregon, there's a river called, and I need to look so I get it right, the Deschutes River. So Israel went out to the river one day, and in the summer it was really popular for people to go like inner tubing in this river and just go out and have a fun time. And Israel was watching these 2 teenage girls this one day who were inner tubing in the river. One of the girls apparently had left, and one of the girls was left alone, and the girl who was left alone, Israel grabbed and ended up raping in the woods. And the unusual part about this, which you will see later in this story, is unusual for the reason being it is not typically like Israel's MO to let people go. He actually ended up letting this girl go, but she never reported the rape to the police, and the identity of this girl has never been uncovered because she never came forward. Because this is a case of her never coming forward, a lot of people say that this is just Israel trying to get dramatic effect out of the police. Some people really do believe it, and this is the first crime that Israel said he remembers committing. In July of 1998, Israel actually enlisted in the US Army. He was stationed at Fort Lewis, Fort Hood and in Egypt for a short period of time, but he was then honorably discharged in 2001 in Fort Lewis, and he was actually awarded multiple awards for his time serving. And the people who were there at the time with him, who served as well, said that he was really quiet and kept to himself a lot of the time. He was a really heavy drinker. He would drink bottles at a time by himself. After he was released from the army, he ended up moving back to Washington State. He lived in a small town called Nia Bay, and that's where he was residing at the current time period. So let me now kind of walk you through how Israel plotted to kill and how he decided who he wanted to kill and when it was going to happen and all of that. Like I said before, Israel was very different from other serial killers because he did not have a particular MO as to the type of person that he wanted to kill. He wasn't specifying to males or females or toward occupation or hair color or things like that. It was strictly if he could kill without getting caught, he was going to do so. He didn't have to know them. He didn't have to have a good reason to kill them. He just wanted to kill them. And something that is so crazy about Israel Keyes, as you will see as we get into this later, he went to great lengths to kill these people and to commit these horrendous and heinous crimes. He would fly to different states and rent a car with cash and drive miles and miles and miles until he got where he wanted, until he saw someone that he wanted, and he would just commit a crime and then he would leave and go back. He was literally just traveling to kill. Israel told the police that he committed his first murder anywhere between July and October of 2001. The location of this murder and the identity of who this person is has always been unknown because Israel refused to ever give out that information. The first identified kill that I could find was the murder of Deborah Feldman. I know we're jumping forward a little bit, but when the police had Israel in custody, they were showing him a bunch of pictures of missing people from the New Hampshire area. And once the police stopped onto Deborah's picture, he stopped and said, "I'm not ready to talk about that yet." And then he eventually ended up telling the police what I'm about to tell you. So Deborah Feldman was a woman who was an addict and she dabbled in prostitution. She just had a rough life. She was someone who needed the money, which was an easy target for him because he knew that he could lure her in and say that he would give her money and then she would believe him, because why wouldn't she, in a sense? Deborah Feldman was walking the streets of New Jersey one night on April 8th of 2009. Israel spotted her immediately and had her get into his car. He lured her, told her he would give her money and everything she wanted. Got into the car and he immediately subdued her with some sort of drug. Tied her hands with zip ties and drove for miles crossing state borders until he got to a place called Tupper Lake in New York. While he was in New York, and while he still had Deborah, who was still alive at this point, he ended up needing cash really badly, and he decided the best thing to do would be to rob a bank. He robbed the community bank in the area, and he wore a face mask, so he was never really found for this. No one really ever knew it was him. And then he went back to Deborah. He ended up raping Deborah and then strangling her, and the theory is that she is somewhere in either Tupper Lake or in that area. But to this day, her body has never been able to be recovered. In 2007, Israel Keyes ended up moving to Alaska and he ended up starting his own construction company. It was called Keyes Construction. He worked as a handyman, a contractor, and a construction worker at the time. On June 2nd, 2011, Israel flew from Alaska to Chicago and he ended up renting a car in all cash. He did all of his transactions in cash and he ended up driving all the way to Vermont. To put it into perspective, it's almost 1,000 miles. He spent 3 days in Vermont and he ended up targeting the house of Bill and Lorraine Currier. I'm pretty sure it's Currier. It could be Corrier. If not, I apologize. Bill and Lorraine lived in a small town called Essex in Vermont, and on one of the 3 days that he was there, Israel went to their house and cut their phone lines. That way they were unable to call anyone. He cut their power, broke into their house, zip tied them together, and forced them both into his car. They did not give in easily. They fought for this. It was said that when Israel was trying to get Bill, Lorraine would try and sneak out of the house, but then unfortunately Israel ended up getting her from there and bringing her back into the house before he put them both in the car and drove them to an abandoned house. Israel took all of the money that they had in cash and he first put Bill in this abandoned house while Lorraine was in the car. Lorraine was actually able to find a way to get out of her zip ties and she started running away from the car, and when she did that, Israel ran after her, got her again, and put the zip ties on her her again. Israel unfortunately ended up shooting Bill in the head, killing him instantaneously, and ended up strangling Lorraine after he raped her, which ended up killing her as well. Both of their bodies have never been found to this day, like Deborah's, and Israel admitted to the police that he was the one who committed this crime. So from just those two murders alone, you can kind of tell Israel doesn't have a specific type. The only similarity in his MO from the cases I'm going to be talking to you about today is when he ends up murdering a woman, he sexually assaults her and then strangles her. That's typically the only consistency I found in these cases. Other than that, it's very kind of free for all. He doesn't have a specific type. So then on the night of February 1st of 2012, Samantha Koenig, who was 18 years old at the time, was living in Anchorage, Alaska and working at a coffee stand called the Common Grounds Coffee Stand. So the coffee stand typically closed at 8:00 p.m. So at that time, Israel was kind of lurking around the area, making sure no one was there, making sure that the coast was clear, and he ended up going up to the counter and asking Samantha for a cup of coffee. So she goes about her task basically and is making the coffee and hands him the cup of coffee and tells him the amount that he has to pay. This is all on security cameras, and watching the video is really, really sad because you can tell she's terrified and it's just really sad to see. So if you want to see that, you can look it up. The video, you can see she turns away for a second to kind of grab something or look somewhere else, or just, I don't know, she just looked away for a second, and when she turned around and went to go grab the money from him, she jumps back and like puts her hands up because he's pointing a gun at her. At that point, he told her to turn the lights off, empty the cash register, to sit on the floor, and to put a jacket on. There was actually a car that drove by at this time, and Israel just jumped through the window of this coffee stand so he wouldn't be seen and no one suspected anything, so the car just drove right by, and Israel ended up gagging and zip tying Samantha. In the video, you can see he walks her out to his car, puts her in his car, and drives off. Here's where Israel made a little bit of a mistake, which, I mean, in hindsight, wasn't the reason he was caught, but he was a little messier with this one. He ended up leaving zip ties and Samantha's cell phone at the coffee stand. So he ended up driving her all the way to his house, which again was something that he typically didn't do. It typically wasn't normal for him to bring someone back to his house, which in reality, nothing was really normal for him. He didn't really have a normality to this, but he had never brought someone back to his house before. So he brought her back to his house and put her in a shed, a freezing shed, right next to his house. So he put her in there. He then realized that Samantha's phone wasn't with her, that he had actually left it there. So he left Samantha in the shed and then drove back to the coffee stand before anyone could notice anything, grabbed the phone and the zip ties. So he essentially cleaned up his trail and then drove back to his house where Samantha was, raped her, and strangled her to death. This is where everything just gets so eerie and disturbing, and with this case in particular. So Israel had actually planned to go on a cruise later that day. He had planned to leave her in the shed until he came back, and then he could do whatever he wanted with her when he got back. But Israel wanted cash because, like I said, he never used a credit card. He never used anything that was traceable. Everything that he did was done in a way that he wanted to make sure that he would not get caught. So he decided that he was going to demand a ransom for Samantha and for her return. He said a public appeal would be fine, anything would be fine as long as he got his money, and he wanted $30,000. When he got back from his cruise, he realized there really wasn't enough money and there was little to none that was raised, so he decided he needed to act fast and find a quicker, better way to get the money that he needed. So this part makes me sick. It makes me so mad, but he had actually staged Samantha's body, making it look like she was alive. He had her holding the newspaper with the current date of that day on it, took a picture of it with her cell phone, and sent it to her parents asking for $30,000. Her parents freaked out but had that hope that Samantha was still alive, so they eventually ended up raising the amount of money that was needed. Unfortunately, what her parents didn't know is at this point Samantha had been dead for weeks. And after nothing happened, once he received And after they raised the money and gave it to him, Samantha still didn't return home, they kind of figured out that she probably wasn't coming home at all. Luckily though, this is when mistakes were starting to be made on Israel's part. So Samantha's parents had wired the $30,000 into Samantha's banking account, and Israel had her phone and had her banking account. When anyone does this, that you take cash out, it says the location of where you are and where you did it, essentially. So the police were able to use that to track Israel's move. Israel was actually in Texas when he got arrested. He was driving along the road, going 3 miles above the speed limit, which is what ended up getting him pulled over. And the officer saw a ski mask, a bunch of cash, and Samantha's cell phone. Police immediately took Israel into custody and started an interrogation, and he admitted that he was on a 14-year killing spree. He admitted to killing 4 people in Washington without releasing their identities from the years of 2001 to 2006. And this is something that I found really interesting when watching his interrogation. His demeanor and his body language is so laid back and so chill, and everything that he says is almost like a tease. He loved being in control. That was his thing. He wanted to be in control. So he would tell police a little bit, but not every. He was just trying to control the situation as much as he could, because he knew that he had information that they wanted. So he was just kind of playing them the whole time. He described himself as 2 different. He said that no one will ever know him in his entirety. No one will really ever know the true him, and no one really knows anything about him because he is 2 different people. He said the majority of the people that he had killed were buried in countrysides or dumped into lakes. He refused to tell the police the names of what most of his victims were. Something to also note about Israel is that he had a daughter. He had a girlfriend and a daughter at one point, and I couldn't find much about them. There was not a lot of say as to what happened to them or their lives, which, I mean, I wouldn't want to be connected to that either, so I completely understand that. But that's something to note, is that he had a daughter. So he was inflicting such pain and fear and terror on these women, and he had a daughter himself. And it's like, if you lack that much empathy, it's crazy. In his interrogation, he said that he actually wanted the death penalty. That's what he was hoping for. Trial was set to start, I think, in the month of March, but on December 2nd of 2012, he ended up actually sneaking a sharp object into his cell, and he ended up cutting his wrist and hanging himself, ultimately committing suicide and dying from that, which police say was his form of his last and final control, that no one was going to be able to determine his fate other than him. And because of this, and because of him taking his own life and being a complete monster, we will unfortunately never truly know how many people he killed or who those people are. All right, you guys, that was the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed another true crime video. Make sure you give this video a thumbs up if you did. If you're new to my channel, hi, my name's Savannah. I make videos 3 days a week, Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday. Subscribe, join the family. I love you guys so much. I'll be back in a couple days with a brand new video. Bye, guys.